see if this works.
Wait a second. So it's not allowing me to paste. Is there something? Oh, maybe it's file.
Okay, I think we are live. Let's double check. Oh yeah, it says I'm live on the... And nice, I see it. Let me just post a few things and then we can get started. So to what degree has everyone messed with these samples? I've heard a few on the Discord, but I'm excited to hear them again. And also, like, how did you enjoy messing with these samples?
Well, I really enjoyed doing it. Yeah. It was a lot of fun, yeah.
Yeah, I remember yours is actually really cool. I'm excited to listen to it again.
Thank you.
Yeah, I thought it was fun because messing with the samples that we didn't, like, it was something that we weren't setting a plan to do made, I think, a whole new kind of like creative flow come out with it, because it was just kind of like what you could do with what you had.
Yeah.
So I mean, I obviously added a little stuff in. It hasn't really changed a whole lot since what I sent to the Discord. So if you guys heard that, it'll be pretty similar.
Yeah, I'm excited to listen again. And I'm going to pull it into Ableton so we can even like look at the spectrum. I'm Sweet. Pumped. I've recently started doing this more, kind of what we've done, where friends will just kind of send me stems, and instead of it being like, oh, this is a full blown collaboration, it's more just like, do you have ideas for this? And then like, you decide what to do with it after. And I think it's actually really fun. I'm glad I could include you guys in that.
They were really like left field stems as well. Like they were really like weird and unique, which was quite fun to use.
That's good to hear. I mean, I think that's where my my personal tastes just keep going. Is like, I keep wanting to try just like new things that I think mostly like stuff I can't really pin down to a style. You know, like I really like pushing myself to just like, and that's what the whole last class was about. Is like being creative to like pushing your creativity to make stuff that you like can't really tie to a genre or a style, and it's just following your own kind of path of what makes you excited. And that's why like the whole sampling yourself thing is really fun, because as we spoke about, it's like entirely your sounds, you know. It's, you can't really replicate that in any way, you know. And so let me get this one post up and then...
And a quick question about it, here. So I just ordered that Shure microphone for the iPhone.
Oh, nice.
Okay, and there's just a software on there that you record through. Is that what it is?
Yeah, the software is called Motiv, like MOTIV, and it's a great little piece of software. You plug in the... Well, one thing I should warn you about is have a steady hand when you're recording it, because you'll get... It's like the same way that you do with a mic that you're holding. Like, you'll get the hinge on the mic itself kind of has a strange sound if you move it around too much. So if you have a steady hand, it sounds great. Sometimes I just go... I work around the noises that the mic make, you know what I mean? Like, if it's rumbling at some point, I just kind of go to a different part that's not... But you plug it into your phone and then open the app. And then in the app, you can adjust things like the style mic that you want to use, whether it's like the stereo or the mono one, as well as like there's EQ settings and compression. I don't really mess with those. I just want like a raw wave. But it's awesome. It's like just this all-in-one app that you can control everything. And then all your recordings stay there. And I linked mine to my Dropbox. So what you do is you can select which recordings you want to share to Dropbox, and then they just automatically upload, and then you have them on your computer, which is really nice. Okay, this has been posted. We are rocking and rolling. So, to start, I want to hear, because I actually haven't even listened to what I did last time. Let me make sure that this works. Can you guys hear that? Awesome. All right. And let's hear it. Yeah, and what's cool about this is it's like not really a defined idea, so it gave you guys all the ability to kind of try, like from what I've heard so far from what you guys sent in Discord, like there's a lot of potential where you can take this because it's a pretty just like bare idea with no like lead or anything. So without further ado, let me put like a spectrum on the master. Why is that reacting like that? Weird. All right. Let me check the Zoom chat. Am I able to do this at the same time? Is there a window for chat? View show chat. Nice. So I am going to grab all of these files. Thank you guys for uploading these.
So one thing for mine for sure, definitely only had that 30-minute flight over. So
I want to hear that one.
Yeah, it's rough. It's really rough. But what I kind of spent the time doing on the trip was actually trying to get some actually good nature samples. Mm-hmm. So it's just kind of thrown in there. So it's super rough. But I just want to preface that. And, okay. Yeah, just mixing up with the sounds and stuff is pretty cool.
Looking forward to volcano samples.
Yeah. Yeah, how was your trip?
Oh, it was great. Yeah, it's definitely a nice surprise for the eruption to start because I'm used to going over there for class back in the day for that. So it was nice to get back over there when it was, you know, having some lava around. Yeah.
Makes it exciting.
Yeah, definitely.
Damn, that's crazy. Direct download. All right, I'm downloading all of these. So let's start with Miles since he decided to speak up. Let's see. Where is... oh, did I stop sharing screen? Yeah, I guess. So
it's super rough.
Downloads. Let's drag that into Ableton. Make sure it's not warped. And it's kind of fun to do this within the project because then we can kind of bounce back and forth. Let's pull it over here. Okay, I'll share my screen again. Bada bing. All right, here's Miles. Can you guys hear it okay? Cool. I'll give it a little volume because you got some headroom, which is nice. Your phone, like iPhone mic, nice.
Yeah.
See, it works because it's kind of already in like a little frequency range just based on the limitations of the iPhone.
Crow Nest.
Awesome. I love everything you added because it like suits the atmosphere of the song kind of. And what's funny is it's like two very different atmospheres that come together in one song, but it works. I could hear this one like building and having more and more drums come in and kind of like really, I could see this having like a really nice, long, gradually building and kind of like coming and going arrangement for, I don't know, it'd just be like one of those songs that's like 7 minutes long and you never really know when it's like the breakdown or the drop and it kind of just keeps coming in and out. That'd be really cool. I'd be curious to hear.
Thanks. Yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking about. Obviously more time needs to go into, but I got these cool bamboo samples just like hitting off some bamboo in the forest.
Oh, nice.
I think I can turn that into some percussion when I have a little more time.
Awesome.
So, yeah, it was definitely some interesting
stuff. I now realize a week is not that long for especially the week of Christmas, so thank you guys for, I mean, doing anything. It's cool to hear, honestly, any creativity going into this is cool. Well, thank you for sharing that one. I want to move on to Ollie's because I remember it, but I don't remember it well enough to like pull it out of my brain. So I'm just excited to hear it. Let's drag that
I will
in.
Warn you, it is quite loud and quite messy. So
that's fine. That's how I make all my stuff. All right, let's hear this. Oh, let me turn off the warp for one thing.
We'll be right back.
This is a cool one, dude.
Thank you.
I really like what you do on the first part of each drop, where it kind of like has this, you do like this switch up with the kicks. It's really cool, like how it's like a delayed bar. I think if that's what you were going for, I mean, or yeah, I'm hearing the first beat rung, but I love doing stuff like that just because at a certain point, like just going right for four on the floor all the time, to me, I always try to change it up a little bit. So I always like when I hear another kind of creative way of doing that. Yeah, this one's really cool. And I like that, like, it's similar to your Privyet remix where, like, it's there's some stuff going on in there that you can tell is from the original, but it's definitely a complete like reimagining, which I really like. Very nice. You're very quick.
Yeah,
it's a good skill to have.
Yeah, I mean, I did most of it in like the first couple hours. So,
so good job. I really like that one.
Thank you.
Cool. Let's listen to another one. Let's go. Class one, I think, is Jeff, right?
Correct.
Awesome. Let's hear Jeff's.
And just a quick thing here. You're not going to hear this one coming, but I got a big smile out of figuring out what your reaction was going to be when you hear this. Yeah, that's all I can say.
All right. Let's check it out.
And the other thing is, listen to how your beat fits into this groove, because this is nothing like what anyone else has got. Okay.
All right. Cool. I'm excited. Let's check it out. Wow. All right. Did you record those guitars?
The guitars are samples, the synths I recorded.
Nice. Well, that was definitely a switch up I did not expect. So I applaud you for the bold move. That's very fun.
Cool.
What kind of synth did you use?
Serum.
Oh, nice. Very nice.
Maybe I used Omnisphere. I can't remember, actually. I think it was Serum, though.
Really turned it on its head, which is an important. We need the bold moves in this group, you know? You need to keep people on their toes. Very nice. Thank you for sending.
No problem.
Yeah, I don't think I expected that.
Yeah, it's really that's the fun thing about this is, like, everyone has their own very unique perspective on how to approach something like a remix or flipping, like just even like a little sample. And it's it would be very boring if everyone just did like the same thing, which was like keep the original drums. And, you know, so I think we're all providing a lot of unique takes, which I like. And then I believe we have Casper's. And Will, did you send anything?
Nothing from me this week.
That's all right. You've submitted quite a lot of your own stuff, so.
By the way, Pierce, I think Rich is waiting to come in to the.
Oh, crap. Call. I always forget to look at the. How do I do this? Well, let me stop sharing my screen and then. Oh, no. I can go participants. Has he been waiting for like a while?
I think so.
Oh, boy. Where is he?
I can go participants. Has he been waiting for like.
Oh, he's probably watching on Twitch. Ah,
I was like watching on Twitch. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah, that's like the secret backup plan now.
Yeah.
My bad.
Yeah, I had to run around real quick, and I tuned in just in time to hear some wicked guitar. So
awesome. Well, glad you made it. I gotta always keep an eye on the participant thing. It like doesn't notify me if anyone's waiting, so my bad. I will get better at this.
My camera's not turning.
That's all good. All right, let's go on to Casper's. Let's see. This one is here. The guitars. What a switch up.
There it is.
Awesome. I really ought to turn off the auto warp long thing. I literally never. I'm just going to do that now because auto warp long samples off. Thank you. All right.
Okay.
Let's check this one out. Get a little spectrum action.
I think you got two playing.
Oh, I have all of them playing. Let's try that again. My bad.
I was like, it doesn't start like that.
That's really cool. And another reason why I love doing stuff like this is like, I would have never thought of making a chord progression or a melody like that based on what was already going on. And it's just like very cool to see someone take, because even like my stems aren't like suggesting any progression already. There's just like the bass line. And so then to hear someone go like, this is what my idea is based on kind of a starting like atmospheric, you know, it is in a key, but you could also take that in a few different directions based on just that alone. And yeah, good job, man. That was really cool.
Yeah, thank you. It was like actually one of those things. I didn't like plan any of it, and I hadn't used Simpler in a while. When you pulled that up, I wanted to use it. So I put the samples in, and it was just that very first tone, that one sound, and I started playing it in like chords, and you know how it loops and you can alter your how you set each note so that when it loops it has a little bit of a tone in it.
So
those chords that I was making, they all have that little bit of like tiny bit of melody in it, and then it just took me right to the lead. I was like, this is easy.
Nice.
When it came to using Simpler again. So thank you for showing me that again.
Yeah, I mean, it's so funny how it's called Simpler, but it's like a very there's a lot you can do with it. And I think it's kind of a very ironic name. I love it. It's like after trying to use different third-party samplers and then finally starting to use Ableton more, like in the past 2 years, it's really a great little tool. Like I wish that Logic just could have Simpler in it. That'd be really nice. But, you know, you can bounce between.
Yeah.
Speaking of which, I feel like I should use Logic today for the second half of the class because I just keep going to Ableton because that's just been where I've been going. But perhaps, Richard, did you submit anything? Oh, yeah, I see the link now. Let's check that. But that's great job, Casper. That was cool.
Thank you.
Yeah, I actually heard everyone's over the stream while I was running around.
Oh, nice.
So it sounds great, everyone, by the way. It's really cool. It's so everyone's so different.
Yeah, I love that.
Mine isn't from the class. I did it right after class, and I think you heard it already. That's the only thing I've done in the week. Because I got really pumped up after our class and I was like, yeah, let's do this. Fuck yeah. And like set up my mic on my desk. I start tapping around my computer and stuff like that. And I threw it together that day. And since then it's just been getting ready for Christmas. So, it didn't use the stems from last class, but got the N64 in the back.
Very nice.
Super Mario in there right now. A little, it's like PS5, right? Same thing. So that's where I'm at with that. It was just something quick after that. I didn't use the stems or anything, but I still plan on using those.
Awesome. Well, it's I mentioned it before, I think before you logged on, I picked a pretty tough week to give everyone just a week to work on something. But I'm glad that anyone did anything. I mean, we've gotten already, what, like 5 different cool ideas? It's awesome.
It's be quiet when you play it, by the way.
Okay, I can give it a little gain boost.
Yeah, pre-doing any.
And these are sounds you recorded, right? Nice. Awesome. I love that.
It's just like sliding my desk drawer in and out and going like this with my hands to the mic. And
was you can tell voice you?
The voice was me. Yeah. Nice. It's just 3 layers of me like humming.
Nice.
With a little bit of processing.
Yeah. And like, you see what I mean? Where like, if you played that idea to even anyone that is like super into electronic music and knows all sorts of subgenres and different artists, like, you can't really like tie that to any specific style or like, you know what I mean? It's because it's just like making music with sounds around you rather than like a 909 hat or, you know, like, so it's, I think it's really cool to even just to like get ideas going this way. And then you could technically replace everything if you wanted, but you could also leave it. Or what I like to do is have like a healthy balance of kind of equal parts, like strange sounds I've recorded around me and then kind of more classic surefire sounds, like, you know, whether it's like loops or stuff from Splice or whatever. I just think that that is what will ultimately add a lot of personality to anyone's music. So I'm glad you guys did this. And I like this one a lot. I think you should keep working on it. It's cool.
It was so like, it's so much fun to make,
right?
Like hitting glasses. I'm like, I want to do this more. So it was so useful that last class. Like,
awesome.
Immediately picked a bunch of stuff up.
Yeah, I'm curious to see, like, based on what we did last week, like, what I would love to hear everyone's like one main takeaway. I know, like, Casper touched on it a little bit, but maybe just to reiterate, like, I'll go around and ask, like, if there is a major thing that you could that just you took away from last class. I'll start with Casper again, just to reiterate.
I think just having something that you didn't I guess something you didn't download and like go and get and something like that, something that you just kind of experienced and had kind of thrown at you in general was made it way easier for a creative flow to come from it. Whether it be recorded samples ourselves or us building it together in the last class and everything like that. I think in general, just having that really completely changed my creative process for this project. And awesome. I was pretty excited with how it turned out.
Yeah, it's cool how like simple activities like what we did last time can kind of reignite a certain fire for creativity just because it's like approaching, like, you know, we've all made songs in ways that we know how, with tricks that we know, with shortcuts or presets or like, you know, channel strips we've saved. And then when you can kind of like completely flip that on its head and like start completely fresh with sounds that you're using around you or whatever, I think it's a really nice like breath of fresh air when you're making music to do those kind of things. And I always am kind of trying to discover more things like that. And I think I ultimately what I'll want to talk about in the second half of this class is like other things that do that for me rather than just sampling myself. Like I'll show you guys for the Ableton people and Logic, a lot of what you can do with like MIDI effects that I use a lot for that same feeling of like, you know, I don't really know what it is I want to make, but I want to make something. And so I like for something to kind of surprise me. That's why I like sampling yourself is fun, because it's just like all you have is what's around you. Try to make something. But awesome. And Jeff?
Yeah. So the thing I really got out of this that I've never done before is I like the fact about going out into nature, going on a trip, going someplace, recording that piece and actually adding that piece of your life into the music.
Yeah.
Instead of doing it in the studio. I've never heard that before. And I really like the idea.
Awesome. Yeah. I mean, it's really cool because I remember having this realization maybe like a year or two ago where like, I'll take all these pictures with my phone and then I never really look at them again. I'm sure in like 50 years when I'm trying to remember some trip or something, it's going to be amazing to have pictures, but I never really find myself sitting and like looking at photos of something that happened. And so I found that by putting these kind of like little memories into songs, anytime I hear that song again, it has the same effect as maybe seeing a photo. But even to me, it's more powerful because it's like, I remember exactly what I was doing when I recorded that thing. Cause I think it takes a lot more intent to sit and be like, I'm going to record this sound for whether it's a minute or, you know, 3 minutes. That's a lot longer than taking a photo. So I think that there's more of this kind of involvement. And so I'm glad that was your takeaway. Cause that's one of the reasons why I love it so much. Like I have songs on over the past probably 7-6 years that I've been doing this type of stuff where I like those will always be specific memories on songs. And like one of my songs on my album Better Places has like a recording from being in this snowy forest in Vancouver, you know what I mean? And it's like that's just like a specific memory baked into the song that no one else knows but I know. And it's cool. I don't know. I love it for that reason. Will?
I think for me, it's like it's the chef, not the kitchen notion. And that I always have this, I have this like hang up about using the right equipment that I'm like, oh, I gotta get the right mics. I gotta get the right synths. I gotta get the right everything. And just like seeing you working with a phone and it ending up so great. And even that conversation about like, well, this is what things sound like now. If you were working in the 80s, you'd have a tape recorder and that would be of the time.
Yeah.
And it would sound rad and vintagey now, but you'd be like, oh, this is all I have. I love that notion that, and you know, like if you listen to like Aphex Twin or like Square Pusher, like we have so much more computing power than they could have ever dreamed of.
And yeah.
They were doing a lot more with all that.
Yeah, that's, I mean, it's funny to be talking about that with this like room surrounded by stuff I've accumulated.
Yeah.
I've actually thought about this. Like if this studio were to burn down, I wouldn't buy anything of this again. Like I would just move on and try and start fresh with new stuff. I love this gear that I've collected. It's all because I've worked and saved enough money to finally buy things that I've like wanted to try, but they don't like make or break my music. It's more so that I've just like wanted to try certain things for a while and finally have saved up enough and whatever and could sell this stuff if I really want. But in the end of the day, like if it all were to go away, all I would need is my laptop and my iPhone now at this point, just to like record little ideas. And yeah, it's very easy to think that like certain things will achieve a certain sound. But the reality is, yeah, it's whatever gets you excited. And some of this stuff gets me excited, and that's why I ended up getting it, you know? But there's certain days where it doesn't, you know what I mean? Like sometimes I'll be playing the synth that I know exactly how much I spent on it, and I'm like, was this worth it? And, but then you end up like making some small thing and you're happy, and you know, it's all about what brings you ideas, and however you get there, that's great. And yeah, I really try to encourage like not so much what it is you're using, but whatever that effect has on you. You know what I mean? Like I know kids who make music on GarageBand on their phone, and I've done it. It's awesome. It's like a crazy program on your phone that you can like play drums with your fingers and have like a sequencer and stuff like that. And it's just like, if you can make awesome stuff that makes you happy or makes other listeners happy, then that's the most important part. And Miles, what was your takeaway?
Yeah, it's just, it was fun and refreshing to leave the computer behind and just kind of go out and, I don't know, just get these unique sounds that can guide the flow of the song versus, you know, trying to find that right sample or sound and then making it straight off the computer. So I don't know, it was just nice. It was refreshing to kind of take this different approach.
Yeah, and it's nice that you happen to have a trip, a small trip, like planned at the same time, because then it kind of furthers the idea that Jeff was talking about of kind of putting them. And like with your idea, what I really like is it, your recordings put you into this space. And like, that's such an important part of music for me is like, you know, I'll make a song and use like Alicia's Keys or some other fancy piano plugin, and it like still doesn't sound good to me because it's just this like perfectly recorded piano with no room sound, with no sound of the piano, like hammers or mechanics of the actual piano itself. And as a result, like it just doesn't give me that sense of like a human is doing something. And that's why I think like, despite how crazy technology will always get, and you know, whether it's like computers writing melodies for us, there's still always going to be this layer of like, I don't know. I have faith that humans will always be able to detect when something is real, even if it's so close and not real. I don't know. It's just a thing I think about a lot, because the music I like has atmosphere to it, whether it's iPhone recordings like we did or recording, you know, their family's old piano and that's been like sitting out of tune. Like that's what Gordon and I do with Leaving Laurels. We record just like random things we come across, and then that just becomes part of the atmosphere, whether it's like an out of tune piano or, you know, we've done a lot of iPhone recordings, like I mentioned last class, but yeah, it's it makes it special. And I want to talk more about atmospheres at some point. Maybe I'll do it in the second half of the class, where like I've done tricks even in my old songs to create these just like unique, very subtle space. I've talked about it before, I think, in one of our old Zooms, like where I went over my song. I think it was when I broke down Quagga, where I showed you guys that there's always this like looping atmosphere thing going on in the background. So there's never like pure silence. And that's a trick I do a lot. I know actually Deadmau5 talks about this. I don't know if he still does this, but back in the day, he talked about how he has this recording of Toronto, like from a field mic that he recorded like 30 minutes of, and he puts it in every one of his songs, at least he used to, so that there is no actual digital silence. There's always some layer of, even if you can't hear it, it's just like a subtle thing for him. And I think maybe if anyone could pick up on the fact that there is this like ambient noise going on very low. I think it's a cool concept, because the idea of like digital silence is quite intense in music. You know what I mean? It's not a very like natural thing, obviously, but it's definitely a part of electronic music, which is cool. And so I think there's like two sides of that, but yeah. And I know, Richard, you just talked about a little bit about kind of what the last class did for you, but if you want to add anything else, feel free.
Yeah, everything was pretty well covered. The simplicity, because in like the Discord group, I don't know if anyone remember, like I've asked multiple times about making drums, and you've answered, because just terrifies me. So even just like percussion and like how easy it was to like, oh, this sounds really good actually. So yeah, that was really cool to learn.
Yeah, because I keep thinking of things I can show you guys. I'm going to write down a few things really quick because based on sampling atmospheres and MIDI effects. Okay. Yeah, I have actually a good idea based on that because, like, I can even show you with your idea that's in here. Check this out. So what he's saying is like having the immediacy of a song, a sound just being like, oh, that is good, even though it's me knocking on my iPhone. Also, Ollie, I will ask you what you took away from it in just a moment. I'm not forgetting about you. This is a really cool, easy trick. If you ever have like, say you recorded exactly what Richard recorded, which is like sounds around him and the rhythm is cool, but you're kind of like bored of the sound quality. You can do something as simple as add this vocoder on Ableton and put on like the noise setting and listen to Richard's idea. Like that's just default setting. At least that's my default, but you can blend it from the original signal, add a blend or all of the vocoder. You can also like do all this kind of shaping to it. And then you can, I mean, I wonder what, I mean, that just sounds weird. I don't even know what it's doing.
Yeah, I just got started on a track that I created the weirdest sound with vocoder.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I did. I threw it on and I started, like, I set the carrier to be like a plugin and it just made the craziest sound. Just playing the settings.
Yeah, I do it with Vocal Synth, that Isotope plugin as well. But you could do it with just Ableton stuff like Erosion, you know what I mean? Now your song is like a shaker. And you could even just have this as like a duplicated thing. Turn these ones off. And now you have kind of just this like noisy hi-hat layer. Pretty cool. So like the moment that that's one of the reasons why I've been loving Ableton more so lately is I feel like the moment that you're kind of bored of something, you can like really quickly be like, I'm just going to do something completely different. And whether that's like warping it and pitching it down 12 or adding a vocoder or actually, you know, it's a really, really cool one I'm going to show real quick is I learned this from Matt Zoe is you can take, I think it's this effect, Corpus, I think. So check this out. If you go to Corpus, and I think if you go Tube, there's a way you can so you can sidechain MIDI, where like, do we have a MIDI progression in this at all? Yeah, we have the granular. So I'm gonna take this. I don't know where we are. Oh yeah, we're over here. So, what does this sound like? Those chords. Maybe this will sound weird, maybe it won't, but let's just see if granulator. See if I can remember how to do this. Okay, hold on. First off, let me take off erosion and vocoder. Oh. And let me see if maybe if I change some of these. Actually, I'm just going to do a whole new progression real quick of just like random notes to see if this will further my point that I'm trying to make. I don't think I remember how to do this correctly. I'll have to rewatch the little clip that I saw of his. But basically, there's a way where you can send MIDI to Corpus to like play progressions on top of the effects that you already have going on. I don't really even know what Corpus does. I think it's like a resonator kind of, maybe. You can get pretty wild stuff. Like the, I know the tube setting is kind of cool. Check it out. Or it's kind of like a delay. But there is a way to be able to MIDI map out like progressions into Corpus, which is pretty cool. So just trying to further my point that like, if you make sounds with samples around you, you don't even necessarily have to use the actual sounds. It could just be a like source for something like Corpus or Vocoder, which is pretty cool. And lastly, Ollie, what was your main takeaway?
Well, kind of similar to what Jeff said, was just like going outside and just recording random stuff and just using them in creative ways, I guess. Yeah. Or even just recording stuff in my room, like, I don't know, like me hitting the desk or something.
Yeah, it's as I've mentioned, it's like the way to make a personal connection with your music rather than just like, mm-hmm. Oh, here's another song that, you know, was all these sounds from my computer or plugins, and which there's nothing wrong with that. But I just think even adding a tiny bit makes it a little bit more special for you. And then it kind of keeps your like love, your creative connection a little bit more alive. You know, it's kind of it's just little things that help. And no one will ever really be able to tell, you know, unless you tell them, especially if it's like a subtle thing that's included in the song. But I think it's important. I don't know if I even have the project, but my song, let me see if I can open it, because it will be a Logic project. But I have a song on my album Better Places called Home in August that uses a lot of this stuff. Where the hell would that be? I have stems. Maybe I can just find it through the stems. Let's see. Do I have the atmosphere? It'd be cooler if I had the project. I don't know where it is. This is why I should prepare for classes more. But let's see. Maybe I can actually use this as a segue into part two of the class. I'm going to open up Logic to change things up. And I'm going to drag a stem from an old song of mine and see. So basically, I thought the second half of this class could be about like just other ways of finding inspiration other than sampling yourself. And I have a few different techniques, one of which is like that, what I was just showing you, the kind of layering or vocoder type stuff. And you can do that with Ableton stock plugins, or as I mentioned, there's this one called that I use a lot. It's called Isotope Vocal Synth 2. And it's cool because it's a vocoder, but you don't have to like feed it MIDI notes. You can just like put it onto anything and it'll start sounding interesting, which is my favorite kind of plugin. Cause you know, I, as you guys know, I'm very, gotta be snappy with my creativity or else I get very bored. So, I always like a good plugin that acts quickly. A lot of cool things like vocoders are helpful for starting ideas. What I often do, and one of the reasons why I've gotten so into doing like tape loops and stuff, is I like to just make like atmospheric beds, whether it's just like one note or like a drone. So maybe I can touch on that a little bit. And I'll actually show you an example of two of those concepts right now. Let me get Logic shared. Bada bing. And mine is kind of wide, so I'm going to make it smaller. Cool. So, my song Home in August from my album Better Places, there's this thing I added. So that recording of snow in Vancouver is actually in Home in August because I was going home from... Actually, I don't know. I think I just randomly put it in. I don't think it has anything to do with the fact that the song is called Home in August. But anyways... If you hear, there's two things going on. And I'll pull this up a bit.
I don't think we can hear it.
Oh, thank you, Ollie. Happened again. Whenever I switch over, I forget to change the output.
No, it's not Pierce Fulton class if you don't forget to do that.
Yeah, I think it's become just a key part of it. Pretty soon I'm going to like do it intentionally and be like, oh, oops. So Logic likes to take a lot longer to change output devices than Ableton, but so there's this iPhone recording, and then there's this other thing that's going on in this atmosphere that I'll point out once I actually am able to play it for you. Come on.
Boo, Logic, boo. Or Ollie talked trash on Ableton last week.
Well, yeah, it deserves it.
Still waiting, bro. Still waiting.
All right, now we're good. Here we go. So, check this out. So there's a few things going on in this. One of which is an iPhone recording of this like snowy forest in Vancouver. And what's cool is, or not Vancouver, Whistler. What's cool is you don't even really hear the atmosphere, but you can hear me whispering to the other person I was with that I was recording it. And I like that ended up being in the song. You know what I mean? It just is this memory, like we were talking about with Jeff. And so that's one layer of this atmosphere. There's also just some like of these shiny little things. I think I got that from Alchemy, the Logic plugin, where I just like was flipping through. On that plugin, what I'll often do is I'll flip through presets and find like parts of a synth preset that I like. So it might be like layer D on some crazy soundscape that I'll just take and start messing with. And it might be like these little like granular type shimmery things. So there's that, but then what my favorite part is, do you hear this like organ sound kind of thing? This, it's kind of swelling this. So what's really cool about that is I have a synth back here called a Juno 60. And this is what I was mentioning to Will is like, you don't need to buy things if you don't have means to, or it's not what you're interested in, but there's little magic that can sometimes come from making music with real things. And one of those things is like this Juno 60 is very famous for its chorus, and but one of the things that's funny about the chorus is it creates noise. And so like if you're recording, like when I record a lot, I record stuff into my mixer and I'll have my Juno unmuted and I'll be recording something else. If the chorus is on, I can hear like a, which is just, I don't know the like mechanics of how the analog chorus works on it, but you can hear that it's engaged. And what's really cool is I discovered once when I was recording something really, really hot. So I had like the gain cranked on something else and the chorus was on, but I could start to hear like this small tone. And I was like, what the hell is that? And then I realized that everything you play onto the Juno, whatever like was the last chord you played or note, it remains kind of like looping in the chorus very, very low. I don't know what that is or why. And as a result, I was like, whoa, that would be a really cool way to like create an atmosphere bed for something. And so what I did was I played like one chord from the song on the Juno, really quiet, then let it decay out and started gradually bringing up the noise, and what I heard was this little swell. So that's not actually the synth being played. It's like silence while the chorus is on, and the like notes for some reason remain kind of going in the chorus effect. And when you turn off the chorus, it goes away. And so I cranked the gain on that, recorded that for like probably 2 minutes, and then put it into this song wherever I felt like I wanted it. And it kind of goes on through this whole thing. and in the outro as well. And so it's fading out there. And you can hear the voice memo as well as this Juno chorus. And that's one of the reasons why I like using certain types of gear or just like experimenting with gear. And because you can find these like unconventional things that happen that might be like, that's my favorite part of this song now, because I just discovered it one day and it was like, whoa, that was really cool. But you can also do that with plugins. You know, I've done that with, like I was mentioning in my song Quagga, I took a stab from the song, put a reverb on it, and then bounced that reverb in place so that it was like an audio file with the tail on it. And then I chopped a tiny bit of that reverb tail and just repeated it. And that was like my atmosphere. And so that's often how I do a lot of things, where and it kind of goes back to another thing we were talking about, which is like creating a space for your song and like having a sense of like surrounding, whether that's this strange chorus thing from the Juno or a reverb tail that's creating some sort of room sound or your iPhone. I think it's just like a really cool way to add personality to your songs. And even like I was telling you guys, like, check this out. You guys can all download these if you want. I'll pull up Contact. So if you have Contact, the newer one, there's this company called Piano Book. And so check this out. I was mentioning Alicia's Keys, which is a great plugin. It's very powerful. It's very high quality pianos. I'll pull up Alicia's Keys. So it's, you know, a very like grand piano sound. Nice, right? I've used it, I've put effects on it and changed it. But to me, it's like very perfect sounding, which is not super interesting to me. And there's this website called Piano Book that people, it's actually one of the guys who founded this company, Spitfire, which makes really, really good contact libraries, these ones. I think one of the guys that started that started Piano Book, which is a like public website where people can upload sampler instruments. You can also download them. So people make pianos, or like I have like a drum set on here, but I mostly really like the piano, especially the like old sounding pianos. So check this out. Like I use this one a lot called Antique, and it's always missing one file, so I have to ignore it. So check out this piano compared to Alicia's Keys. Let me go up an octave. So you hear, you can actually hear the room that it was recorded in. That I will go to 10 out of 10 times over Alicia's Keys. Cause like, even though certain notes are out of tune, like, you know, like let me find an octave. That one's okay. That one's pretty out of tune, but I love that. You know what I mean? You play a chord and it sounds real, because a human played a piano that they had in their house. And so I'll even if it's not like, you could have a layer of this piano and then have something else like Alicia's Keys or some other type of high quality piano. But if you like this kind of stuff, I would recommend going to Piano Book. It's like, I think it's pianobook.co.uk. It's a UK company. But they have all sorts of amazing ones. Like I've gotten, this one is really crazy, I think. You can just hear it kind of like wonky, and it's not like totally perfect. And I like pianos like this. Even the noise on top of it, I don't know if you can hear it through Zoom, but there's all this, Like, I love that kind of stuff because that's what sounds like a real recording to me. So I highly recommend this for if you want to create space, because even you can even like what I did in Home in August. Let me try and record just like. Hold on, let me find a decent. Let me take that, like unquantized, turn it into audio. And this is literally what I did for my atmosphere in Quagga, where you take a small snip of this, loop it, but I made mine a lot shorter. I think it was like this. So there's all this stuff going on in it. Let's see. You could even remove these frequencies so you're not really getting the tone of it. Oh, smaller. But like, this is the stuff I really like, the fact that can't really hear it when it's soloed, but the room noise, and I could do things like, let's see. For example, I have this Wolf compressor as a plugin that is like a really cool compressor, but it has its own like noise and wow and whatever, but you can kind of find like a lo-fi type setting where maybe, let's hear what these sound like. Like even the distortion one, it's like, and then you could do something like this. And that little tiny room sound, whatever it is that made you inspired, could be the beginning of a song. Now you've sidechained it and you kind of have a rhythm to it. And you could start doing things like my favorite plugin, Nerve, and add some. Sorry, I didn't mean to duplicate that. And also give the Logic users some redemption. Well, I mean, I guess Ableton can have this as well, but this is like my funny version of like drum rack for Logic, if anyone were ever to be interested in that, because I really like how this works. Go by date. It's funny, I always flip through kicks and then just end up going for the same one. Let's see where it is. I've been liking, where is it? I know it's called like Dance Hall. Yeah, it's this like knocky distorted kick. Oh, should mute my Home in August. I actually just got this free plugin tip. The Arturia just put out literally a plugin replicating the chorus I was talking about. But the difference is that this chorus won't have that weird, you know, underlying noise. I don't think, at least. But let's see what it sounds like.
Yeah, I literally just got that a couple days ago.
It's awesome. I love it.
It's pretty good.
It's sick that you can do manual, like, Ooh, and then ready for, can you not do MIDI effects on, I guess you just have to have like a separate channel. Let me see. Let's see if this would work. I've been using this modulator plugin a lot. And if this can work, then I will be very impressed. But basically you can go learn plugin parameter. Go, okay, can't be learned. Automatable. So it has to be on the same channel strip. That's annoying, because the Ableton LFO and Max for Live thing, I think, can just be on any channel, and you can just like redirect it to it, which is pretty cool. But basically, I wanted this to be just randomly changing rate at a way that, because you can use this modulator to do that, but it apparently has to be on the same channel. But how would you do that with an audio? Huh, that's kind of a bummer. But anyways, you could always do it with automation. And let's see if I have a nice, what's cool is I already have kind of an idea for this based on that alone. So I could delete that original piano that I did. So let's try that. I don't know why I have my keyboard here, because it's like impossible to play, but it's the only place that it really fits on my desk in a nice way. I want to do, let me see. I'm actually going to leave a lot of stuff unquantized, because I'm trying to do that more instead of have everything locked in all the time. And then, even if it means unquantized by hand, let's see. It's a little off. So that's kind of what the reason why I'll make these little atmospheres is, like, that's where my brain went when I heard that loop going da 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 da. So that's kind of where my brain would also go. I can even just do that by, let me try it like this. Oh no, then. Thank you. also, I'm going to give you another reason why Nerve is really cool. So I have the kick going on. And I need to do this more where... Let me find my drum loops. You can drop loops into it and it chops them in a really cool way. So I can just go like... So right now it would just play like a one shot, but if you click this, it'll play like a loop and it'll go. And so it's a cool way of like warping where it's not actually warping it, it's just chopping the file into equal parts. But you can hit this R and start getting like random patterns, and then you can flip through. And if I wanted to go back to that original. See, like, even that's pretty cool. All right, now I'm not loving my whole unquantized thing. I just want downbeats now. Do some strings. I'll actually show you guys that Spitfire company I was telling you about. It's awesome. They make really good strings. Do you guys have any questions based on what I've been doing? I'm just kind of like following my nose and trying stuff. I believe it's this. All right, this thing is awesome. Check it. So check this out. So if I take that, there's all these different settings, like these tremolo settings, check it. Go an octave up. try to turn this into a multi-output thing. I forget how you do that. Oh yeah, you go like this. So I can go like this and set the output. Where is it? Output 1 and 2. I can go to 3 and 4. I can do this one. I really like this because I used to just like duplicate it. I think you guys have seen me do it before. But in this case, you can. Now they're all on. Because I wanted to like put a little transient shaper thing on this. Come on.
Sounds like Stranger Things.
The bass? Oh, yeah. I mean, this is like, I love this preset. So Monarch is a Native Instruments clone of Model D. And this, like, I forget which preset this one is, but it's just like, it sounds very, very similar to an actual Model D, which is nice. Just doing a quick little syncopated thing. Thank you. think the like most irritating thing about producing for me is finding a snare. And I could probably be more like organized about how I do it, but this is literally what I do every time. Or maybe we just won't have a snare. See, this is where the like kind of out of tune pianos might sound kind of funky, but let me go back to what I had. It's fine, just like two notes. I mean, I keep going with this, but the whole point of this is showing you how I'll take something like a small, like ambient noise or room noise, like we started with here. And that just helps me come up with the rest of the ideas for the song. And maybe this is as far as I get. And I go like, all right, I'm done. Maybe I'll, and you know, and if you guys were just like a fly on the wall of me just making music every day, I might do something like this, stop right now and go like, I don't know about this. And then in like 2 days, I'll open it back up and more ideas will come because I haven't thought about it. And that's literally how I go about making my music. I know a lot of producers out there will say things like, you should finish everything you make. And I think if that helps you finish songs in the end of the day, that's great. But you know, everyone has their own process. And like this is part of my process, is just making small ideas and then finding ways that they fit either into other ideas, or that, you know, if I come up with more in a few days, or I might like go for a walk later and this song will be like kind of circulating in my head and then I'll come back and have other ideas. It's really just a matter of kind of following your nose. And for me, doing these little sounds like this room sound is kind of like what definitely gets the spark going when I need. So that's one way of stringing ideas. Do you guys have any like similar techniques that you've ever had as like surefire idea starters? Maybe yes, no.
One for me that this actually kind of reminded me of, when we were doing the Foley, you know, project and everything, I always pretty much have to go back to piano on everything. And that's, I think, where I feel the most creative with, you know, my process. And so like when I had the samples in there, I just kind of played around on the piano until I found something that sounded in tune and in key with it. And then that's that little piano melody that I have, and the buildup of the project I ended up using, just literally sitting there on, had my little keyboard and I was just going a couple of notes, and then it followed along and really kind of brought it up to the build up and then into the drop. So I think going back to my most comfortable instrument or my kind of first experience with music in general really helps me, even if I have a project that's, you know, 95% serum crazy stuff going, I'll pull up a piano real quick and all of a sudden take it in a completely different direction. So that's one of the big things for me.
Nice. Yeah. I mean, that's like, I've often talked about how, like, this is my way of doing things. And the cool thing with music is that everyone will have their own unique process or approach or whatever makes them excited. And so, like, that's why I think things like what we're doing, where we share techniques and, you know, styles of music that we make, it's like cool to, it's kind of like eating a dish at a restaurant that you really like, and then you go home and you're not going to like try to make the exact same dish, but, and it's probably very hard to make it, but it might make you approach something you normally make very differently. And so, like, I think that's what's really cool about learning these different techniques, because I don't expect you guys to do the exact same things I do. I just hope that maybe I show you something that allows you to try something else on your own. And yeah, so I think it's a it's cool to learn other people's things. Yeah, not necessarily to do the exact same thing, but just to have ideas from it. Richard, do you have any? Oh, sorry.
It's okay. A couple ideas that I use for ideas. First is, the best ideas I have always happen first thing in the morning.
Yeah.
So that's one thing, is I try to, it comes from some sort of inspiration. If I'm just trying to randomly create something, a lot of times what I do is I have a big chart with all the keys on the wall, and I just pick a random key out of the blue. And then I always start with the bass, because that's always going to be where the root note's at.
Yeah.
And I just pretty much start monkeying around with something in that, whatever key I'm going to try to play with, and get a handle on just any kind of basic idea that I'm motivated on.
That's a good, yeah. I've heard of someone rolling a dice and like using a combination of two dice to decide something, whether it's like key or tempo or something. And yeah, I really ought to do that more, because I literally just will like tap a note on the piano and then I'm like, okay, I guess that's the one we're playing. And then I just like go from there. And most of the time I'm not even thinking about what note it is. I'm just trying to come up with my brain to go like, what's the, like, what is a logical harmony based on that? So yeah, it's sometimes it's a good technique. Sometimes it's not, as I'm sure everyone's ideas tend to be. It's not always 100% accurate or reliable, but it's at least something to try. That's cool. I agree. Mornings are usually pretty good for me. I'm kind of envious of the people that can work at night, because there's something about like not being able to get calls from random things, you know, like sometimes first thing in the morning, it's like you just have life hitting you with different things and you're like, oh boy, I got to do this, do that. And, but like in the evenings, I just get so tired that I don't know. I don't work well when I'm tired on music, unfortunately, but maybe one day. Anyone else have any little tricks they use?
Yeah, Jeff said one of the ones I was going to say, where I spent a couple days in the summer doing like a little music theory, just to learn keys and not really chord progressions, but like, yeah, like keys. And then, so I have like a few sheets on like my desk beside me, and I look at them and I'm, let's try this. And and I start I lay out the different chords in a certain key, and then I just start 4-1-5-7, you know, like see what happens, and then maybe like something clicks. Then the other, sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, and then the other thing is I, in the past, I've just, you know, maybe I load up Serum or something and I just start clicking through samples, and like I've spent like 2 hours just sitting there clicking through presets, sorry, not samples, and like one note will strike a certain, you know, like,
yeah,
do 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 do, and then I'll try and build off the one.
Yeah, that's why I'm a huge fan of presets, because it's like, it not necessarily to just like make a song out of a preset. It's more so that it's like, when you don't really know what you want, sometimes it's nice. That's why I like plugins that have randomization features, where you're just like, I don't really know what I'm looking for right now, but something might jump out and go like, oh okay, that sounds interesting, let me follow that. So yeah, I like doing that. I used to do that a lot. I used to have this weird obsession. Every time I got a new plugin, I had to hear all of the presets. So I would be there like, and then like highlight the ones that I like. And yeah, now I don't really do that because I realize you just can drive yourself insane. And I kind of like the idea that like every time you open it, you might not have heard the sound and you're just like, oh, okay, cool. Let's see what that sounds like. Yeah. And to touch on your theory thing, like something that's cool about using learning and using music theory is that if you're stuck, you have logical decisions made for you, basically. Not, well, not made for you, but just choices. Like you can go, I'm on this chord, therefore most likely these next few chords would probably work, you know? And I don't use it enough because I'm so used to my, the way that I started producing, which is strictly just going by ear. But when I stop and then kind of think about concepts of music theory, I can do it, but I still don't really connect the two parts of my brain, which is really weird when I'm like writing ideas. Cause I think part of me kind of likes having the naive aspect of just not thinking about that and just like playing notes and being like, hmm, sounds nice. And then like figuring it out later, what it is I was doing. Just a technique that I've always kind of done. So, yeah.
I'm curious if anyone else does this, or if it's just a me thing, but like if, like I, things just come to me sometimes, like I'll hum a random thing or it just like I'm thinking about it on like a bus or something. So I'll record myself like doing the rhythm or the melody that, so like I got like hundreds of megabytes of videos of me in my car, just like singing into like an idea I have. And then later I get home and I like play it and I'm like, no, that was shit. Or I'll, you know, be like, yeah, okay, try it out. So I have like, I record myself throughout the day if something just randomly pops into my head.
Yeah, man. I think a lot of us can relate to that. I've been doing this thing where I used to record my guitar ideas into voice memos, but then if I like, was, because I do the same thing with guitar. Like I know guitar theory much better than I know piano theory because I've played a lot longer. But more often than not, I'll just kind of start to noodle around and not think about logically like what I'm doing. And it's just a fun way of like experimenting. But as a result, I'll kind of use these like shapes that I don't really know what they are, but I can, like I said, in later on analyze it and go, okay, that's this chord and just a different shape. But I used to record these things in voice memos and then I would not remember like where I was playing it on the neck. And I was like, oh God, I'm never going to be able to play this song again. So now I have this entire folder of videos that are from my phone where I set up my camera and I like play it and I have to like give it the same angle as like I would be while I'm playing. And they're pretty dorky, but it really does help now. Like, cause I can, I'll record an idea like not around a studio and then like months later be like, oh, I wonder how that sounds. And then now I have these videos thankfully to show me how to actually play it again. Cause otherwise it would be impossible.
Hey, Richard, I'd like to add something onto what you said. It's a slightly deeper, more spiritual level on this, but I think it's kind of key. So when I was 12 years old, I had a cassette recorder and I started singing a song. And of course I didn't know anything about music, right? And the next year it came out on the Sticky Fingers record by the Rolling Stones and was a big hit. And then 3 years or 4 years later, I was playing in a band and we recorded a song and it ended up becoming a number one hit for the Cars a couple of years before. And I noticed this process that was happening over and over again. And then finally one day I spent the day with the bass player from Merle Haggard. And he told me that in the 60s that he went in the studio on a whole bunch of drugs and recorded about 100 songs, okay, that weren't put in there. And that to this day, they keep popping up as number one hits on the country charts. So I think that there's this flow of music that goes around us at a level that we're not conscious of. And of course, at 12 years old, I obviously didn't have the tools to recreate the song, but somebody did, right? And they were able to pick it up. So I think there's a tremendous amount of value in tapping into that and recording those ideas. Because I think that you'd be amazed what can come from it.
Yeah, and cool. That's a concept I used to kind of think like old ideas are old and I have new ideas. And in the past like 5 years, I've adopted the absolute opposite where I treat like every idea very, I don't want to say preciously, but I see them all equally because literally the other day I was flipping through my voice memos where I didn't have the actual video of how to play it. And I was trying to just remember how to play certain little ideas. And sometimes it's just like two chords, but after a certain amount of time by like going through these ideas, I realize a lot of the times that I have like three small ideas that come together and could be actually a really nice single idea. And that's like my favorite feeling of all time, because I typically write songs in very similar chord progressions or just like relatable like movements structurally. And so last week I did this where I was like, huh, this song goes from here to here, and then this song is kind of like a little chorusy type sounding thing, and now I just put them together. And like now, probably 3 years from now, I will finally have the excitement to fully write it and record it. But like, that's just this kind of like catalog thing in both my computer and my brain where I'm like, I know those chords exist. And I also might be like sitting down with Gordon, my partner from Leaving Laurel, or some other artist, and maybe whatever it is we're doing that day will like kind of strike, maybe that idea will come to my mind and I'll go like, ooh, I have these chords that have been sitting around for 3 years. Do you want to hear what they sound like? And then that might be the song you work on. And so I'm a big advocate for recording everything and just having it somewhere that's easy to remember how to play it, what to do with it. And there are plenty of voice memos on my phone that are like, and I listen again, I'm like, what were you trying to do, dude? Like, there's nothing you could use from this. But I have a song called No More from like 2015. And I came up with that, why don't you tell me? I'm like in the shower one day and just like recorded it and then sent it to my friend to sing the vocals. And like, it was just like a random, you never know. Sometimes they're crappy ideas and sometimes they could be a massive song that just came from like a tiny little experience. It's crazy. So I think it's, I agree with Jeff. There's like, there's this, cause there's certain days where like I'm making music and I'm like, dude, what is wrong with you? Like, are you ever going to write a decent song again? Like, are you done? Is it all over and you got to like pack your bags and go back to college or something? Like, I've had days like that where I'm like, I don't know what's going on, but I can't like make an idea that sounds interesting. And like, so I agree. There's some strange thing that happens when you allow yourself to be creative, and it, not just music. I think in everything, it's like getting out of the way of whatever it is comes to your mind and just giving it a chance. And I'm, as you guys have seen, I'm like so impatient where like, I'll make this loop that we had today and then I'll be like, I'm tired and I'll go do something else. And, but that's just my process. Cause then maybe I'll come back tomorrow and I'll have an idea for a different part of it. And yeah, but I know people like my brother, he'll have an idea and he'll spend like 8 hours finishing the whole thing. And I'm just like, oh bro, jeez. It's, yeah, everyone's different, but, do you guys have any questions based on anything we did today? No? I could challenge you for next week in trying to do what I did here. Here, let me share this again. Try and do this where you take a single little sound and loop it and then add some effects to just kind of spice it up so it's not so stagnant the whole time. And as you remember, this was just like the tail of a chord that I played on a sampler. And typically if there's something else besides the notes themselves, whether it's like a room sound or, you know, that has like noise from it being recorded with microphones, it'll add just a little bit extra texture. But I think it'd be kind of cool to see what you guys would do with making just a little tiny repeated element. And in this case, like I have it going in this like syncopated rhythm, but you could do it as like that or just quarter notes. So I would challenge you guys to try and do, even if all you make is that, just see what happens. Because it could be fun. And if it does inspire an entire idea, then that's cool too. Are you guys fine with that? Like doing little challenges each week? And like, as like the length of Richard's was totally fine. Just like a small idea. Because I do that all the time. But if you're like Ollie and you create and arrange an entire full song in 2 hours, then that's cool too.
Not too much free time.
I mean, dude, I'm jealous. I wish I could finish songs that fast. Like you're throwing songs into the Discord like it's hotcakes.
I thought I was like so fast. I was like, yeah, I whipped this up right after Pierce's class and immediately after Ollie. Yeah, I made this thing here. Check this out. Like,
it's like fully polished.
Yeah, it's so much better.
It's a good skill to have. So use it well. But yeah, I encourage any contribution. I think there's ideas in every little thing that you do that at least you just put creative energy towards. So, and it could be something that, say, Richard's idea or Miles's idea, there could be a year from now and you go like, ooh, I want to reuse that sound that I recorded on that trip into this new thing. Like it's almost like you're building your own sample pack that you can always use from. That's how I see making ideas. Cause this thing that we're working on right here, like I could just use the piano melody and something else later. You know what I mean? And I just think that's pretty cool. So never get discouraged if you get like stuck in a loop, cause there's always maybe a use for it. And I've even started doing that with my songs with Gordon for Leaving Laurel. Like I've made us a sample pack where I'll take drum loops that we've made and just like have them live in there so that we can use them. I mean, I did it initially for our live show, but now it's like, wow, if we need like really quick drums, I can just go into our sample pack and it's stuff that we've already made. And I know a lot of like of the more bass leaning producers, like I know like Feed Me does this a lot where he'll just spend days only making sounds, not trying to make songs. And then you have this pool to draw from in the future. And I think that's pretty cool. I need to do that more. Yeah. So that's my challenge for next week.
Sounds good.
And do you like, I mean, I'm kind of just improvising based on each class, but I think this is kind of cool. It's like we do something and then the next week we all kind of listen to what we do. And then like, I just kind of thought of this while I was listening to your guys' ideas of this new technique. So maybe I'll kind of do that. And just like, you guys can suggest things obviously in Discord to cover, but, I think it's kind of cool to have the classes do these like crossover between each week, but then also some new stuff. And it doesn't always have to be like producing small ideas. It can be something DJ related or, anything else, but yeah, I hope this one was cool for you guys. And
love it.
If I don't, well, I guess the new year's not for, oh wow, so our next class will be in 2021, so I'll see you guys next year
if we make it that far. If 2020 ends,
yeah, and it just
loops.
Yeah. Awesome, well then yeah, I'll see you guys next year.
Yeah, thanks, Pierce. That was awesome.
Thanks, Pierce.
Thank you. See you, Pierce.
See ya.
Bye, guys.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, guys.